In this special episode, we speak with some of the influential leaders in the pro-life movement. Marjorie Dannenfelser is the president of Susan B. Anthony Pro-Life America, previously known as the Susan B. Anthony List. We spoke to Dannenfelser before the group announced their new name and expansion. She told us how and why she got involved in the pro-life movement. And joining us now is Marjorie Dannenfelser, president of the Susan B. Anthony List. Marjorie, thanks so much for being with us. Could you start by just telling us about the beginnings of the Susan B. Anthony List? What inspired you and the women around you to do something about the reality of abortion in America?
Well, ironically, it began in my living room, and I'm speaking to you from my living room right now, a different one, but completely committed to the idea that there should be authentic women's voices speaking up for life, for the women's lives and the lives of children who are being elected to public office. So there were really no women, pro-life women, elected to public office at that time, only like one or two. But there were so many on the other side. And we also noticed that there were very strong lobbies for all sorts of interest groups, tobacco, dairy farmers, all sorts of interest groups, and also Emily's List, a very powerful pro-abortion pack for women, and nothing for the unborn. So that was the beginning. And as we grew, we were able to increase in scale so that we could be effective in electing statewide office holders in battleground states, men and women, so that we could eventually get to the point where we are now.
Could you talk about some of the most challenging moments along the way and some of your proudest moments as well?
Well, I guess there's no question that probably the most difficult thing, Mother Angelica, I bet, agreed in the beginning, was that raising the funds to do what you needed to do to increase the scale, to be able to make a big difference and high impact, because lives are on the lines, was probably the most difficult piece. But just like Mother Angelica, the women that and men that I worked with early on and still have always first put this in God's hands. Just when we thought that the next step was not going to be possible because we couldn't scrape together the funds to do it, something happened every time at the last minute. It's become almost a mantra on our team that God has provided even just the financial resources. He's provided everything else, the people, the need, all of that. But it's happened over and over. Rewarding is, I would say there's no point more rewarding than this one that we're living in right now.
Right. And in light of this moment, how has your vision of our role as pro-life Americans changed over the years?
Our vision over the years has changed and it stayed the same. There's one thing that's always been, and that is that we had to get to a place where this human rights battle of our time was solved by the ingenuity of Americans that were using the tools of democracy in order to fix that human rights abuse, the greatest one this nation has ever seen. So really, the vision of how that would happen seemed slow and was almost five decades. In God's time, that's just a blip on the screen, but what it is the loss of many souls and many children to the tragedy of abortion.
Yes.
So the vision is the same, but now the job is very different and very exciting, the most exciting ever. And that's to get to work, electing these folks, making sure that we get laws that are on the books that protect the lives of unborn children and their moms.
Mm. And Marjorie, I know you and I share our Catholic faith. As a Catholic pro-life leader, can you speak to the role of the church in raising awareness about the injustice of abortion, especially in the culture that we live in today?
In the very beginning, from the very beginning, but even before Roe versus Wade, the church was at the heart of this question. And this question has been at the heart of the church. And that is, how do we treat the least among us? And while it's not been perfect over time, it has been consistent over time that there have been great bishops and great popes who have communicated this into the hearts of the faithful to keep us going when we were on our knees and not able to see where to go next. As a convert to the faith, I wouldn't be sitting here right now if the church had not enlivened my soul and my heart and my intellect to really apply all of that to this great cause. I owe everything to the church, particularly Pope John Paul, and EWTN has been a major part of my formation. So if it's true for me, I know it's true for everyone else.
And you are no doubt a wonderful addition to our Catholic family. Marjorie, what is your message to those who are pro-abortion?
My message is receive our love. And when you receive our love, know that it comes from your Creator, and know that that we all have a common project now, and that is to tend to the needs of women and children. And let's do this together. We know that there's common ground, and we know that that everyone wants to make something strong and mission-centered in their lives. Let's make this mission together. Let's put aside whatever differences we have and serve the women who say yes to life.
Marjorie Dannenfelser, always an honor to speak with you. We're so thankful for the work that you do at Susan B. Anthony List.
Thanks so much, Prudence.